Welcome back to the Political Checklist here on the Rundown blog. I'm the political editor here at the NewsHour, David Chalian, joined by senior correspondent Judy Woodruff. Gwen is off today for the checklist, but she'll be back, we promise. Judy, obviously tomorrow, huge speech coming up with the president, State of the Union speech. And we saw a couple Republican leaders out over the weekend trying to pre-spawn to the speech and sort of set parameters on the issue of spending. They hear from the president that he's going to talk about investments, and they say to them that means spending, and immediately the battle lines got drawn.
Well, the president, the White House has found a way to talk about what they want to do for the next 2 years between now and the election. And that involves, yes, it involves trying to deal with the debt, but in a bigger way, what are we going to do about jobs? And spinning it toward the future. Optimistic. I keep thinking back to Ronald Reagan in 1984, Morning in America. Now, that was a much more auspicious time in terms of the economy. We are still in a very difficult place in 9+% unemployment. But the White House, the president, are looking for a way to get Americans to think positively about what we face and the cuts we have to make. And Republicans are pushing back.
Right. But the this is what I don't get. The president says he's going to talk seriously about the need to pay attention to deficits and debt, but that he refuses to pull back on investing in education, in infrastructure, in technology, anything that is part of this quote-unquote competitiveness agenda. And the Republicans today on Capitol Hill are trying to slash $100 billion from the current non-defense spending. How do those two meet?
They don't meet. Again, what they're trying to do is frame this in a future focused agenda.
But,
that's right,
yeah.
And saying we're not just talking about, yes, we need to deal with the deficit, but we can't do it too abruptly. We've got to wall off those areas that will create jobs, not just right now, but in the future. But you're right, Republicans are saying no. This smells like spending. You may call it investment. We are completely focused on getting the deficit down. We did hear an interesting wrinkle, I think, though, from Eric Cantor, who is one of the top.
The House Majority Leader,
the number two Republican in the House, who is now saying that they would consider cuts in defense, which is something we have not
heard. Right.
He
put that on the table. Right. Some of his colleagues still want to keep that walled off.
Exactly.
Talk about this moment for the president. You were comparing to Reagan a little bit, thinking back to that time. But this is, in some aspects, a kickoff to his reelection campaign. And we are seeing this big pivot post the November elections. You know, like the State of the Union captures the attention of the American people like no other presidential speech. So what are the stakes here for him? How does he have to use this moment?
The stakes are huge. Having said that, we say that about every State of the Union and about every major speech that a friend. The stakes are huge. They're huge because the audience is big. Maybe 50 million people will be watching. He's in a better position, David, though, than he was right after the election. I think a lot of people thought, justifiably, after the November midterms, that the president was going to be, in a pretty defensive posture for the State of the Union. But they had a successful lame duck session. His speech in Tucson after the terrible tragic shootings there, well received. He's coming into the State of the Union in a stronger position. And I think that gives him a little more leeway to do what the White House wants and not be so defensive about explaining what they want to do.
Of course, he'll have a Republican speaker over his left shoulder for the first time.
For the first time in John Boehner. And what we're hearing is that the president will say some nice things about Mr. Boehner in an effort to promote this bipartisanship. And by the way, we're going to be looking to see who's sitting together out in the gallery, Republicans and Democrats. Who knows how much that means substantively, but symbolically, it'll be interesting.
And I'm sure the president will reference it if it actually looks different to him from up there. Before we go, Judy, raw politics 2012 Senate race taking shape in Virginia. It could be a rematch from 2006. Former Senator George Allen is announcing today he plans to seek his old seat.
That's right. He was defeated by Jim Webb in 2006, 4 years ago, and he's saying, I'm going to come back for this. Jim Webb has not announced yet, the moderate Democrat, whether he's going to run again. The circumstances are, I think, not so clear for the Republicans. The president won Virginia 2 years ago, it's become much more friendly to Republicans since then. But I don't know that Republicans can count on the state of Virginia. So this is going to be an interesting race.
It is interesting. Since that election,
one way or another,
the governor of Virginia went Republican, a couple House seats went Republican, so it will be a real battle.
And we don't know whether Webb is going to run. Tim Kaine has made noises about running, the former Virginia governor, about running again.
And the current DNC chairman. It'll be a fascinating race to watch. There's no doubt about that. Thank you very much, Judy Woodruff. That does it for this edition of the Political Checklist. Be sure to check here on the Rundown blog all week long for State of the Union reaction. We'll have it all for you. Thanks for watching.